All right, so let's get started with today's topic with our instructor, Mr. Partha Mishra. He's an experienced data scientist who is associated with several organizations providing competitive solutions and bringing in good results to the companies. And he's also passionate about training and mentoring the budding aspirants into AI. So that's it from my end, and thanks for staying with me. Hope you guys will have a great session ahead. Hi, Partha. Over to you.
Thank you, Nancy. So let's begin the session. I'm presenting my screen. Okay. So today we'll see about the main focus will be on the polynomial regression. So here basically I'll start off with showing you what are the main libraries we need to import. We'll be using some of the libraries which is not present in the current packages of Python. So we need to install a few libraries. So some of them are like matplotlib, seaborn, plotly, and there's one really interesting package for visualization called Bokeh. And for machine learning algorithms, we will be using scikit-learn and the stats model. So if you want to install the libraries, you can utilize these commands. Okay. Now, the basic libraries which we'll be using for data analysis are pandas and numpy. And if we need to use them, we need to first import these particular libraries. So let's do that. PD and NP are the aliases for pandas and NumPy. So this is one of the basic conventions that the data science community follows. So even if you Google a few of the codes online, and if you come across this term PD or NP, you should understand that pandas and NumPy is being used in that particular code. Okay. From the SciPy packages, we will be using the stats part of it for the statistics. And in that, we will focus mainly on the normalization and the skewness. So let's start importing those. I'll be also importing the stats part directly so that in case we need something else, we can simply import stats. Okay. So there are two major concepts called kurtosis and skewness, which we'll be using in statistics. So before we actually utilize these and apply them in our code, let's try to first understand what kurtosis is and what skewness really is. So for that, let's see what kurtosis is. So if you understand this term called normal distributions, in normal distributions, what we usually say is we have a mean value, and we say that almost 99.7% of the entire data revolves in between plus or minus 3 standard deviations. Okay, so here we can see if this particular line, which is in the center, this is the normal distribution. And plus or minus 3 deviations are the extreme values. Okay, now what happens? So if we focus only on normal distribution, it's something like this. Okay, here where we can see the mean, median, mode, all of them lie in the same part. And we have this symmetrical difference. That means if you take one half of it and you just take the mirror image of that particular half, you can actually see the other half. Okay, so this is what it means whenever we say something is normally distributed. So it means there is uniformity in the data. Okay, so where does kurtosis come in? So kurtosis comes in when there is a peakness in this particular data. So if normal distribution is somewhere over here, let's say if our data is having a lot of peakness. So let's say if it is positively, there's a positive peak in the data. That means this entire data, or you could say the area under this curve, is going to remain constant. Okay, so if I peak this particular curve, that means this particular piece is going to stretch and it is going to take some of the area away from the edges. Okay, similarly, if we try to flatten this particular curve, so the normal distribution, let's say if somebody puts some kind of pressure on it, then it's going to become something like this, kind of a plateau. And what happens when and the area is not going to change, so this particular area that is now getting pressed down is going to go into the edges. Okay, similarly, if we talk about skewness, again, every time there's this thing that we are going to compare everything with the normal curve. Okay, so this normal distribution is over here in the middle, that is also called as a symmetrical distribution. So when we talk about skewness, what we're focusing mainly are the outliers, or those data points which are having lot of deviation from the mean value. So whenever we say something is positively skewed, that means if our mean value is over here, there's a positive side, you have some number. So let's say if our mean value is, let's say it's 30. So there is some data point which is maybe, let's say 100, 150, which is lying to the particular extreme. Okay. And similarly, there can also be something called as a negative skewness. So let's say our mean value is something around, let's keep it again 30. And this time it is going to be negative 100. Okay. And one clear information, what you can see is the median is always going to be in the center part. Okay. Median is one such attribute which does not get affected by outliers. But you can't say the same thing about the mean. Mean is the only particular thing which gets very much affected by outliers. It's something like mean is nothing but the average of the numbers. So if you have, let's say, 50 students, and 50 students are trying to get the average mark in that particular class or particular subject. So if there's one student who performs really well, let's say the performance something around 90, whereas the class average is around, let's say 75, then what would happen is because of this particular mark, the entire mean can also shift. So if more number of students start getting scores closer to 95, then the mean can shift from 75 to, let's say, 80, 85. Okay, so mean is one such attribute which gets really affected by outliers. Mode, not so much, because mode is nothing but the number which gets repeated. The most frequent number of times is nothing but the mode. So for mode to get affected, we should have more number of such data points. So you can see for positive skewness, we have the mode which will be always less than the median. and it will be always less than the mean. Whereas for negative skewness, this particular two values are going to interchange, because mean will be affected by the outlier. So mean will here in this for negative skewness, our case will become mean is less than the median, less than the mode. Okay, with these concepts, let's continue our discussion. Now, for data visualization, I'll be using these four libraries, Matplotlib, Seaborn, Plotly, and Bokeh. So let's start importing those particular libraries. So I'll start off with Matplotlib. We'll be using some of the most widely used parts of Plotly. Okay, so we have figure factory and we have graph objects, which are widely used for creating the graphs. Since we're in the Jupyter notebook, I'm going to take the advantage of this init notebook mode, and we are going to connect it with our Jupyter notebook. So I'll simply say connected is equal to true. Okay, so now let's just discuss what exactly have we imported here. So Plotly, we have something called as tools, which are generally used for creating the plots. Make subplots is, as the name suggests, whenever we are trying to split our particular plot into two or more parts, we can create subplots using the make underscore subplots. Figure factory and graph objects are two of the most widely used parts of Plotly. This is used because if we need more vibrant colors, or we need some extra graph objects, we are going to use those particular pieces. And Plotly offline is basically used whenever we want to create something offline. And let's say we want to create this plots inside the notebook itself. We don't want we don't want pop-ups to be coming up. Okay, so Matplotlib and Seaborn, whenever you're running this particular charts inside the Jupyter notebook, we always get it immediately after the command. So inside one notebook, you're going to get the code and the graph. To do the same thing inside for Plotly, we are going to take the help of this notebook mode so that particular graphs are created inside the notebook itself. Okay, so let's import these. So I'm going to run this part. Okay, Bokeh is one of those few libraries which are extremely versatile when it comes to different chart types and the kind of, you could say, beautifying the particular charts. So if you're going to take Matplotlib to create the similar kind of plot what we get in Bokeh, you're going to write a lot of particular code. The libraries which is little better than Matplotlib is Seaborn. In Seaborn, you can within one line of code, you can actually create your particular charts. But by doing so, the only disadvantage you might have is for customization, you have to either stick with the default, whatever Python is going to give us in the plot. So by default, I mean the default color or the default setting. And if you want to customize it a bit, then we can go for plots, like we can go for libraries like Plotly. The one particular library which is most widely used these days is Seaborn and Plotly, as well as now recently we have seen many like people using this Bokeh library for plots. So inside Bokeh also, let's start importing whatever we require. Okay, for the pre-processing of the data, I'll be using the scikit-learn library. Specifically, I'll be using the label encoding part of it. Okay, so for that, we require only one line of import, that is from sklearn.preprocessing. Import label encoder. Now, for the machine learning part, that is for building the polynomial regression, we'll be using scikit-learn. And also we will take the help of stats models to find out which particular components we require. Specifically, we'll be using stats module to calculate the ANOVA part of it. ANOVA stands for nothing but analysis of variance. So we will be taking the help of these two libraries to build our models. So for scikit-learn, we will simply say sklearn dot model selection. For splitting the data into training and testing, we require the test train split. Next, we require to import both the linear regression and the polynomial regression piece. I'll tell you why we require the linear regression, but first let's import them. So linear regression you can import from sklearn.linearModel. Okay, for building our polynomial regression, we'll be taking the help of this polynomial features, and using that along with the linear regression, we'll be building our polynomial regression equation. That is the reason we require the linear regression model. Now, for the stats model piece, what we will do is we will only consider taking the linear regression piece of it. So even using stats model, you can also do the linear regression, but for the time being, what I'm going to import is directly I'll call the stats model API, and I will be taking the standard deviation piece of it. So here we will say import stats models as SM. SM is another alias we have for stats model. So whenever you look at a particular code and you find this term SM, you can understand that stats models has been used for building this particular code. So here I'll do a small correction. Instead of only stats model, I'll just call the API piece of it. Okay. Out of this code, the major thing that you have to understand is we are importing the stats model API as SM. And here we have only taken a small piece of the regression for calculation purposes. I'll tell you exactly where we are going to use this. Now, the next most important thing after importing all our required libraries is we have to understand the data that we are going to work with. So for understanding the data, first thing let's do is let's load our data. So I'll be calling the data as DF, short for data frame. And we're going to read in our particular file. So this is named as insurance.csv. So I'm going to read this particular file insurance.csv into this data frame called DF. Okay. Now, the next thing, as soon as you read the file, you have to understand what exactly the file contains. Starting with, let's say, we want to know how many entries do we have. That is, number of rows and columns. Okay. So for doing that, we can simply say print df.shape. The dot shape attribute is going to make sure that it's going to tell you number of rows and the number of columns. So we have about 1300 rows and 7 columns in our data. Okay. Now, to understand exactly what is present, so we have understood that we have about 1300 rows and 7 columns. Suppose we want to know what exactly they are. And we don't want to see the entire data, but we want to see a small piece of it. So what we can do is we can go for the head method. And we can see the first 5 entries in this data frame. So we can see we have age, gender, BMI, number of children, is the person a smoker, region, and the target variable that we are interested in is the charges. So whatever insurance cost the person is going to incur is present in this column called charges, and that is going to be our target variable. So based on the other columns, we are going to build a model which can take in this details of the other column and give us a number for what can be the particular charges. Okay. Now, here, if you look at the columns itself, we are seeing there are a few columns which are in object category. That means they are strings. So we have the gender and we have the region which are in strings. Even smoker also you can consider as a string, but if we convert into binary, yes and no will become 1 and 0. Rest of these particular columns are all numbers, and as we know, most of the machine learning algorithms work with data which are completely numbers. So there are a very few algorithms which can actually take in the strings as it is and give us any kind of prediction. Most of the machine learning algorithms would want us to do some kind of pre-processing to our data and bring every column into numbers. So that being said, we know we have to do something about this gender and region column and even the smoker column and get these particular columns into numbers. Only then we will be able to process our data. Now, this is what we understood just by looking at the head. But if we really want to understand, now the next question is, does this data have any kind of missing values? Okay, for checking that, we can simply take the help of the info method. Info method is short for information. So information regarding the data frame, that is complete information. If we run this, Python is going to give us a neat table which tells us about the columns, the total number of entries. So we can see in the range index, this is the number of entries that we have, 1338. Okay. And every column in here has 1338 non-null values. That means there is no null entry or there's no blank entries in this data frame. Okay. And as we discussed before, gender, smoker, and region are the only 3 columns which are in the object data type. So we have to convert this particular data types into numbers. Remaining everything are in integers and floats, which is good enough. We can process our data if they are in integers or floats. Okay. Now, let's say you don't want to do an info, but you just want to figure out what are the columns which are object data type. Okay, let's say somebody is feeling lazy and the person doesn't want to do this head and all. Person just wants to know what are the columns which are present in this object data type. Okay, so for that we can simply do this particular command. So I'll simply say print df dot select d types. And inside this, I'll mention the dtype I want. So we are looking for strings, which is nothing but the object. I'll simply mention select dtypes as object. And here I'll simply mention, I don't want to know everything, just give me the column names. So I'll say dot columns. Let's run this particular piece. So here we can easily see that these three particular columns are in the object data type. So either of the two, but I would suggest you always take this route of dot info, because here not only it is going to give you what are the data types that are present, but it will also give you the information about if the this particular data frame has any kind of missing value. So let's say, for example, if smoker had two data points missing, then we would have here 1336. Okay. So looking at it, you can easily figure out whether we need to do some kind of imputation or not. So in our case, we don't need to do any kind of imputation because the entire data is complete. Okay. Now, so we need to do something about these three particular variables. So let's first address that. So I'll be converting this particular data type from object to something called as category. Okay, so let's convert this to categorical variables. So let's create this. So I'm copying these three names. So we have a list of object categories present. So these three columns are objects. Now we have to convert this into category. So I can simply mention a simple for loop. So let's say for column names in our list called object category, we're going to take each and every entry of this particular object categories. So I'll say df of column name. This is equal to df call name dot. We have to convert this into from object to category. So I'll be taking the help of asType method. So in asType method, we can simply mention category. Okay, so by doing this, what it is going to run, this particular code is going to run through all the column names present in this object category list. So we have three columns. It's going to take individually one column after the other, and it's going to convert this particular column into category. From object class D type to category, it will be converting. So let's run this. Okay. So once this is run, the next step which you have to immediately do is check whether everything has been run successfully or not. So for that, I'll simply mention df info. And this time, let's see if everything is converted properly. So we are successful. All these three columns are now as defined as category. We don't find any column which is declared as object. Okay, now let's focus our attention to the numeric variables that we have. Okay, this numeric variables, the main thing that you have to focus is, you can use something called as a describe method, and you can check the details present inside the describe. So if I simply do df.describe, if I run this, it's going to give me the column names, and it's going to give me this particular calculations that system has done for us. So the count, we know 1338 is the count for every column, so we can ignore this. If we look at the mean value, once you get a describe table, the first thing you have to always focus is on the mean value and the maximum value. These are the first two things that your attention should go to. So let's say here we have everything in order. That is, we don't see any kind of extreme values. So here, let's say, for example, the age column, we have the mean age is around 39 and the maximum value is 64. So it is not like the maximum value is some multiple of the mean. So let's say if the maximum value were something like, so if it's not the age, so if I simply say, let's say charges. Okay, let's take charges, for example, it will be much better because the mean charges is around 13,000. And it's not that the maximum charge is almost 10 or 100 times the value of the mean charge. Okay, so that way we can make sure that the data is not having extraordinarily extreme values. Okay. The one thing which I really like to do is instead of seeing the dot describe method the way system shows us, I like to take the transpose of this particular table. Okay. Now, why I like doing transpose is the fact that here, now the columns will come into the rows. And I can actually scroll this way and I can see the particular value immediately. Okay, but it's up to your personal choice. Either you can do just simply dot describe or you can take the transpose and look at it this way. Okay, now we know that charges column is the one which is our target variable. So the discussion we had on kurtosis and skewness, let's apply all this information to this particular charges column. So we have to now understand the distribution of this charges column because that is our target variable. So we have to figure out if there are any kind of outliers in this charges column, or is the distribution similar to a normal distribution, or can we expect some changes. So for doing that, I'm going to create another variable called let's call it charge distribution. So charge test. And inside this, I'm going to take this particular column DF charges, but I'm going to consider them as a array. So for converting this particular entire column into an array, we have to use this dot values method. It's not a method, it's an attribute. Okay, so dot values attribute is going to get us this information into array. Now, one of the easiest ways of converting any kind of values into, let's say, checking into normal distribution is where if we take a logarithm of that particular value. So we'll do the same thing. So let's take the logarithm of this charge column and we also plot this particular information and see whether or not we get a normal distribution. Okay. So I'm going to call this variable log charge. That's the logarithm of charges. And let's take the help of NumPy to create the logarithms. So np.log is going to give me the logarithm values. And inside this, I'll simply pass in the column name. So df of charges. This particular command is going to give me the logarithm of the charges. Now we will try and build for the distribution of medical charges. We'll be creating histograms. Okay. And we'll also create subplots of the histograms. Okay. So for creating the subplots, we are going to take the help of Plotly. And for Plotly, one thing you have to always remember is we have to create something what is known as traces. So every piece of that particular plot is called a different trace. And we're going to build these different traces separately and then bring it all together into one chart. Okay. So let's start creating the first trace. So let's say I'm going to call this as trace 0. Since we are building histograms, so let's say go.histogram. Okay, and inside this, the x variable, let's say I'm going to call the, take the x variable, the one we created, so charge test, and this is another parameter called test norm. Okay, and inside his norm, what I'm going to mention is I'm more focused on the probability part of it. So I'm going to say the probability. So his norm is focused on the probability of this particular column. Let's give it a name and let's call this as exactly the same thing. We'll just call it a charges distribution. Now, once this is done, let's also give it some nice marker. That is, we are going to give it some different color so that we can distinguish. So in this marker, I'm going to pass in a dictionary. So there are two ways of passing dictionaries. One is this general curly braces that we have. Other piece that I usually like doing is directly called dict. Okay. And inside this dictionary, I'll simply say color is equal to. And this time I'm going to, instead of giving a particular color name, let's go for different codes. So we have color codes available for Python. For different color codes, you can simply do a Google search and you will get a link where you get all the color codes possible. And for this, I have this color code called FA5858. Okay. Now, here you have to, while plotting in Plotly and even for Bokeh, one thing you have to be very careful about is the braces. So I've seen many students getting confused with the number of braces, and it is pretty common, like the number of braces that we are going to keep inside this. And depending on what kind of complexity you want to give to the graph, you have to be careful with the number of braces. So here, if you want, you can leave these two braces like this, or you can actually, to make it even more clear, you can actually do something like this. Because any which ways, we can give extra spaces. So we can be clear that this particular bracket is for the dictionary. So this is one piece of it. And inside the histogram, we have actually declared all of these values. So histogram, this is the beginning piece, and this is the end piece. Okay. Now, this is a for trace zero. Similarly, let's now start plotting the trace one. For trace one, in the first trace, that is trace zero, we have taken the directly the charges column values. So in trace one, I'm going to compare this with the logarithmic values. Okay. So we're going to follow almost a similar kind of thing, but this time with different values. So go dot histogram. And inside this, this time for X, I'm going to go for the log charges. Okay. And remaining, we can keep it the same. So his norm is nothing but the probability. And the name this time we are going to give it a little different value. So I am going to call this log charges distribution. Let's give it a different color. This time I'll go for different color code. we have these two traces that we want to build. So two histograms, you know, so we can do the same thing. So we have trace zero and trace one, which we want to build, two histograms. And let's say I want to build these two histograms side by side. That is, we want to create a subplot. Okay. Now for creating the subplot, we have to actually take the help of this make subplot that we imported before. So I'm going to say something like figure is equal to make subplots. And here you have to be very clear as to how you want the subplots to be. So here, let's say I give the rows equal to 2. And let's give the columns is equal to 1. Okay. So 2 rows and 1 column. And to this, let's also give it a small title. Subplot title is, let's call this charge distribution. So you can actually give the same titles that we have actually provided previously. So I'll simply copy this, whatever name we have given. Okay, so titles we can say here, charges distribution, comma. Next one we have is log charges distribution. These are the subplot titles that we have. Okay. Now, after this, we can simply say, let's say if we don't want the grids to be present. Okay. Then what we can do is we can simply say print grid is equal to false. So I'll simply say put a comma here and I'll say print grid is equal to false. We are not going to have any kind of grids in this particular graph. Depending on how you want to customize it. So let's say if you want the graphs, you can simply ignore the print grid, this particular piece. Okay, you can actually remove this and you will get the graphs in grids. Okay, now that we have declared what kind of figure we want, that is subplot is there with 2 rows and 1 column. Now we have to actually include the traces that we built before. So trace 0 and trace 1, we haven't used it till now in the make subplots. Okay, so we have to include this to this particular subplot. So the easiest way to do is using the append. Okay, so dot append trace. And here I'll mention as first, let's take trace zero. Because remember, we actually took the titles in that way. So charges distribution is corresponding to trace zero. And the log charges is corresponding to trace one. Okay. All right. So since we are doing the append trace here, instead of taking the traces directly as trace zero and trace one, we have to make a small change. And what would be the change is the fact that we have taken subplots. So we have to tell Python clearly where exactly Python has to put this particular plot. So when we append the trace, let's say append trace of trace zero, let's say we want this particular chart to come first, that is in the first row. So I'll simply say 1, 1. Okay. So you can consider this as a matrix of 1 column and 2 rows. So by saying trace 0, 1, 1, I'm clearly telling Python, take the first column and take the first row and place that particular chart over there. Okay. Similarly, we can do append dot trace to the other. So here, when I talk about the other, I'm talking about the trace one. So in trace one, we'll again stick to the first column. Okay. And in Python, you know, it's always row, comma, column. So here we have to say second row and first column. Okay. trace 0 was 1 comma 1 and trace 1 is 2 comma 1. If you want to keep it in the right order, you can also give spaces like this so that your code looks a little bit more neat. Okay, now once this appending is done, the next thing is we can make our particular chart a little better by selecting the layout and modifying the layout a little bit. So I'll simply say fig of layout. To this, I'll simply say update. And let's say we want to see the legend. Okay, so I'll simply say show legend. And let's give it a, we already gave titles to the subplots. Now let's give one title to the entire plot. So you can consider something like a master title. Okay, so title, let's consider on this title as charges distribution. So since we have already used the word charges distribution, I'm only going to write it as charge dust. Okay, so that we don't get confused between the titles. And because this is a histogram, if we also want, let's say, to for this histogram to look something like a bar plot, so we can actually give some gap between the bars. Okay, and to do that, we need something, we can use something like bar gap. Okay, and in bar gap, usually you have to put in small values. Don't give very big values to the bar gap, because if you give big values, your chart will start looking a bit odd. Okay, too much gap, again, it's not going to look that nice. Now, once this is done with the layout, the final piece is actually plotting out the entire thing. So using iPlot, we can plot it inside the Jupyter Notebook. So this particular component that we have, fig, that is the first value that you're going to put inside the iPlot. And in general, we require to give it a name. Okay, although the name is not shown anywhere in the graph, still Python works that way. So we need to give it a file name. So let's call this file name as, let's keep it something complicated this time. So custom sized. Subplot width. Subplot titles. If you want, you can actually keep the title simple, but I'm going to keep it very, very clear. Okay, so we're actually creating a custom plot with subplots. That's the reason I've given this file name in such a long manner. Custom size subplot with subplot titles. Okay, now with all of this code, now let's run and see how the plots have actually built. So let's run this. Okay, iPlot is not defined. So we have to check where we have actually missed iPlot. Okay, and there we have to actually see in this particular imports that we have done. So iPlot is part of our Plotly. Okay. So in Plotly, we have actually missed out, I think, over here. This is the piece that we've missed out. We actually imported download plot.js and init notebook, but we haven't imported the iPlot piece. So we can run this once again, and let's go back to our chat and let's run this particular code again. So here you are seeing the star mark because we have a little bit of code that has to run. Okay, so always remember this particular customization that Python is providing you comes with the cost of time. So if you give too many traces, so let's say I want to create a very complicated chart, and although Python permits me, and if I build something like 10, 15 traces, then it is going to take that kind of time to actually run the entire cell and give me the output. So now let's look at the output and see for ourselves what exactly has come out and what is the kind of distribution we have for this particular charges column. So looking at the charges column, like the values that we had, the first thing that we can see is it's not a normal distribution. So there is some kind of skewness in this data. Okay. So now looking at the concepts that we have seen. Okay. So what is this particular graph like? Would you call it a positive skew or a negative skew? Or let's say if I have to put it in even more simpler terms, will you call it a right skew or a left skew? If you want, you can simply write your answers in the chat. So if you don't want to speak.
Positive.
Positive, correct. So it's a right skew distribution. So if you look at this particular values, most of the values are between, let's say, we can say it's between 2000 and around 12,000. Okay, the most interesting and most useful part whenever you do charts using Plotly or Bokeh is that whenever you hover your mouse inside the chart is going to give you the exact value. So here, remember when I said we were plotting and in the histogram, we had actually mentioned we require the probability of those numbers. So here, when I actually hover, and let's say I'm focusing over here. So all the values between 4,000 and 6,000. So that particular bar corresponds to 4,000, 6,000, and the probability of those numbers is 0.1195. Okay. So this is the benefit you get whenever you're doing your plots using Plotly or Bokeh. This kind of benefit you may not get when you're doing plots using Matplotlib and Seaborn. Not that the plot will not come. You will also get the similar kind of plot inside. Suppose you do plot using Seaborn, you'll get the same shape. But if when you hover your mouse onto that graph, you will not get any extra details like the one we're seeing right now. Okay. So this additional, or you could say this is more information that we can actually get using Plotly or Bokeh. Now, this was the raw data, that's the charges column. But when we look at the logarithm values, this is corresponding more or less similar to the normal distribution that we had. Okay, so normal distribution say or shape, when we saw this kind of U-shape or bell-shaped curve, here we wouldn't say exactly the same thing because it's not exactly normal distribution, but it is very similar to a normally distributed curve. So when we took the logarithmic values of the charges, it's actually corresponding to a normal distribution. So we can say by taking the logarithmic values, we have actually tried and saved some of the outliers from affecting the chart altogether. Okay. So this is the advantage of taking the logarithms of those particular values. You can clearly see that when you compare these two charts. Okay, one we know definitely has the positive skew or right skew, And by taking logarithms, this has come closer to somewhat of a normal distribution. All right, this was a charges column. The next column that we can focus on is, let's take the age column. Or here, if we look at it, in this age column, we are seeing a lot of different values. Okay, some of the values are also repeating. So to make our lives easier, what we will do right now is, let's give this particular data into different buckets. So let's say I'm going to take this particular age column and convert this age column into three buckets: young adult, senior adult, and elder. So for young adult, we have taken something like 18 to 35. Senior adult is 36 to 55. And anybody who is above 56 is, I'm considering this as elder bucket. Okay. Now let's try to build our chart based on this particular buckets that we have decided on. Okay. So for that, the first thing that I'll do is I'm going to create a new column. So let's say I'm going to call this column as age underscore cat, or age categories. Okay. And I'm going to take the NumPy NaN. By doing this, what I'm saying is I'm going to create a column called age underscore category, which has completely blank values. NaN stands for not a number. And usually it comes up whenever we have no data present in that particular column. So since we are creating a new column and it does not have any data for the time being, we are going to assign all the entries as NaN. Okay. So this is what this particular piece does. Now, let's say I'm going to create a list. Okay. So I can't use this word LIST because LIST is keyword. So because I want a list, I'm going to just call it LST for the time being. And I'm going to take this particular data frame. Okay. So the entire data frame, I'm going to convert it into a list. Now, for column in LST, we're going to write a for loop. And now that we have decided that we're going to break this data into three buckets, we have to actually do that, right? So let's say 18 to 35, we have young adult. That means whenever we're looking at our data, so when we did a dot head, so this person who has the age of 19 will fall in the first bucket. Okay. Similarly, depending on the age, we have to fill in this particular values that we created. So age category column that we created, we have to fill those values. So for filling those values, I'm going to take the help of a for loop. Okay. So for column in LST, the first thing that we have to do here is I'm going to take the help of the LOC method. Okay. So the exact location I'm going to take. So col.loc. And inside this, let's do some filtering. So here what I'll do is we have to focus the entire thing on the age column, right? So based on the value of the age, we are going to assign it that particular class out of those three classes that we have focused on. Okay. So here inside LOC, what I'll do, I'll simply say column of age. And whenever this column is greater than or equal to 18, okay, and the column of, we have to give additional brackets. The additional brackets are required so that Python doesn't get confused. Okay. So the reason why we are keeping this entire thing is because we want to clearly tell to Python this is the first condition. Okay, so column of, that means this age should be greater than or equal to 18. This is one condition. So to make it very clear to Python, we have put them in this braces. Okay. Similarly here, we have to mention column of H. Now this time it should be less than or equal to the number 35. Okay. Once this is done, this is the condition what we wanted. Okay, wherever this condition matches, what should Python do now is what we have to mention here. So after this, I'll simply put a comma and we have to give this particular column that we created, that is HCAT. In the first line, we put everything as an NaN value. Now we have to start filling in those values. Okay, so wherever this particular condition matches, we have to call that person a young adult. Okay, so I'll simply say is equal to young adult. Okay, similarly, this was the first piece. Now the next thing that we can do is call dot loc. And this time we have to go for the bracket of 35 to 55. Okay. So I'm going to repeat the same thing, but with different numbers now. So age. This time the age should be greater than 35. And this time it should be less than or equal to 55. Once this is done, wherever we get this condition to be matching, we have to give the value of this age category column as we were calling this as a senior adult. Okay. Once this is done, the last piece is nothing but somebody who is called as an elder. So here we don't require the AND operation. We can simply say this call dot loc all of age. Anybody who is above the age of 55 is considered as an elder. Okay, so here, comma, okay. These are the three brackets that we wanted: young adult, senior adult, and elder. Now, coming to the next piece, we have this particular for loop is complete. Now what we require is something like we have to create the labels. So for the labels, I'll take the help of unique values. Okay. Now df of hcat dot unique, and this particular unique values I'm going to convert it into a list. So I'll simply take the help of toList. Okay, so this is this process of writing one command after the other is also called as chaining. Okay, so here you can see df hcat is our column. After this for loop runs, depending on the value of the age, the person will be assigned to any of these three categories, either young adult, senior adult, or elder. and I'm taking the unique value and I'm converting it to a list. So instead of writing these commands in two different lines, what we can do is we can write the same thing in one line itself. Okay. So here we have the labels. And now the most important thing is, let's go for how many people are into each of these brackets. So I'm going to call this as amount. DF of age, cat. And here I'll take the help of value counts to find exactly how many people belong to each of these particular three categories. So here we have value counts. Similarly, value counts also I'm going to convert into, okay. This happens because sometimes when you hit tab autocomplete and you're not getting it in that particular time period and you start typing in, both the things can occur. That's the reason it started autofilling that particular piece. Okay. And also value counts I'm converting into a list. Now we have the labels, we have the amounts. Now, since there are three categories, we can also provide them with three different colors. Let's do just that. Colors, I'm going to give it a list of three different codes. Okay. So we have this one. Second color code, and the third we have these are the three color codes that we are going to give for three particular age groups that we have. Okay, now here comes the most interesting piece. We are going to create a pie chart. Okay, pie chart, which is going to give us the distribution for these three groups that we have: young adult, senior adult, and elder. So let's see how we can build a pie chart. So I'm simply going to call this as trace, and here I'll mention go dot, since we need a pie chart, so we can simply say go dot pie. Okay. Here we will take the help of this list that we have created. So we have labels. And the labels, I've actually given the same name here. So labels is equal to labels. So here, please don't get confused. This labels is part of dot pi. Okay. And the labels that I've mentioned here corresponds to line number 9 that we have. So this line code that we have mentioned, hcat.uning.list, this values that are present are going to be part of this particular labels. Okay. Similarly, the next piece is nothing but values, and values we have mentioned as amount. Okay, so value count information, I'm going to put it in the value. Next, to make the pie chart a little more interesting, it would be really nice if when we hover on the chart, we get the label and we also get what is the percentage of that particular group. So till now, the only calculations that we have done is we know the number of young adults, we know the number of senior adults, and the number of elders. But if we actually hover onto the pie chart, if we can see some percentage, so let's say if we get something like 20% is young adult or 30%, something like that, it would be really nice to have that on the pie chart. So we can do that using this particular piece called hover info. Okay, hover info, you have to mention clearly what exactly you want to see. So let's say I want to see both the label and I want the percentage values. So I'll simply say label dot label plus percentage. So I'm instructing Python to show me both the label name and also the percentage of this particular group. Okay. Now, next thing what we can mention is text info. It will give us some more additional information. And here inside this additional information, I'll simply put in the values. Okay, so these values will correspond to the amount. So value counts, it will also give me those particular that information also. Okay, now apart from this, let's actually create the font size to be a little bigger inside the text. Okay, so let's say we call it text font is equal to, we'll give it a dictionary, and inside the dictionary we'll say size is equal to, let's say for the time being we'll keep the size is equal to 20. Okay, now previously also we saw this, there's something called as marker, and inside this we can also give it a, we have actually defined these colors right on in line number 12. We actually gave this particular color codes, so we have three color codes here, but this is in the form of a list, so that we can actually assign it to this marker. So this would become colors is equal to colors. Okay, similar to what we saw in tables, it's the same thing. Colors is part of the dictionary, and this equal to colors, this colors corresponds to line number 12. Okay, and now some more modification that I would like to do is I'll just add in line information, and inside the line information I'll also give it a dictionary, and for this line I'm going to give it a color corresponding to this code. And I'll also give it a width. So let's say we don't want very thick line, so I'm going to stick to a width of 2. Okay. So the trace is complete for the pie chart. All that is left to do is we have to define the data. So data is nothing but the list of this particular trace. Since we only have one trace, we can simply say the list of trace. Once the data is ready, we have to complete the layout. So layout is equal to go.layout. And here I'll simply give it a title. And let's call this title as amount by each category. Okay. Now once the layout is also defined, only thing left to do is you have to create the figure and plot it. So fig is equal to go.figure, and inside this we have to give these two things data. So data will be corresponding to this line number 20, what we have defined now. Data is equal to data, and layout is equal to layout. Okay, so here data will correspond to line number 20, and this layout will correspond to line number 21. So once the figure is also ready, all that is left to do is using iplot again. So iplot fig comma, and this time I'll give a file name as, since this is a basic pie chart, we'll simply call it basic pie chart. You can give it any name you like, but always remember we need to give a file name. Okay, that is how Python is functioning. So let's run this and see what kind of plot we have actually gotten. Okay. Okay, so here it says snow attribute to list. Okay, can anybody tell me what kind of error I have made here? This is a very basic error that I made. So if you observe in line number 9, you'll understand what is the error I made in line number 10.
Is it that you forgot your brackets after value counts?
Correct. So it's always a method that we have to call. So if you actually read the error that we have gotten here, it is saying this particular object doesn't have the attribute to list. That means it's referring to value counts, doesn't have something called as to list. It's just that we are actually calling to list after we wanted the value counts. Okay. So here we can make this correction and run this chart again. Okay. Percent. Okay, there's some kind of malfunction with labeled or plus percentage. Let's only keep it percent for the time being. Okay, so this was the error. Text info should be only value, not values. So this shouldn't malfunction anymore. All right. So you can see, even if you make a small error, that is how you have to start debugging this entire thing. So now if you look at this particular pie chart that we have, if we hover on this, it's clearly showing us the percentages. Okay, so I said label plus percentage. That's the reason it's also showing us senior adult 41%. Similarly, young adult is 42%, and elder is 16%. Okay, so this is the kind of plot that you are going to get. And the colors that I've mentioned were corresponding to these particular colors. If you want a different set of colors, you can change those particular color labels. Okay, so we have our pie chart, and looking at the pie chart, we can see that the entire data, most of this data points are like most of the people are either senior adults or young adults. So there are very few people who are in this elder bracket. Okay, so we can say this age category, we have to check whether it is a very significant variable or not. If it is very significant, we know there'll be some kind of biasness coming in because this data is not completely balanced. That means not all three are 33, 33, 33. So if we divide 100 by 3, we get 33.33. Okay. Here it's not the case. Here we have two categories which are almost taking up 80% of the data. So 41 and 42.9. All right. Now, since we also know that body mass index is related with the age, so depending on how old the person is, the body mass index is going to have a particular change. So it's like if we have middle-aged people, they're not as active as teenagers. So we can consider that they're going to put on some weight. Okay, so let's actually do the similar kind of activity between BMI and age. So we have BMI is equal to DF of BMI. And just like before, I'm going to take the help of dot values, and we are going to take the two lists. I'm going to convert this into a list. Next thing that we have is we are going to create the group labels. And here we have, I'm going to call this as, let's give it the full form. So body mass index, let's write the full entire thing. Okay, these two are ready. Now, since we have only BMI, so we'll give it only one particular set of color. All right. Now I'm going to create a distribution plot, but this time instead of taking the plot list go, let's use the figure factory method, okay, or the one which we have taken as FF, and let's create the subplots using let's create the distribution plots using that. So it's something like FF dot create this plot. Okay, and here I have to simply mention those variables that we have actually created before. So BMI. Next, we have the group labels. And we have the colors. One, you can simply say colors is equal to colors. OK. Now, once this figure is ready, we can give it a title. So for giving the title, I'll take the help of this layout, and let's update the values there. FF layout dot update, and we need to update the title. Our title is nothing but normal distribution. I'll just call it normal distribution. And once this is done, let's take iplot and plot this entire figure. And here we have to give it a file name. So let's give the file name as basic distribution plot, basic dist plot. Okay, run this. So we have a basic distribution plot here. So we know our looking at the plot, we can easily see that the BMI is actually normally distributed. Okay, and this second graph that we have here, this is also a very important way of looking at the same data. Okay, so normal distribution, you can actually see normal distribution, and we can looking at the bars, we can see that most of the data points are, you could say, are concentrated in this particular around the mean value. Exact same thing you can see looking at this chart. So here, instead of looking at the entire distribution, it's going to plot in what are the points we have. Okay, and if you look at only this particular piece, we can say that this is also normally distributed because most of the data points are hovering in between the range of 25 and 35. Most of the data points are concentrated there. And there are few outliers in the ranges of 50 and this particular value, 15. Okay, so these are the two ways you can actually look at the normal distribution plot. Now, the next thing that we have to see is, now since we want to build the model and we are taking the help of linear regression to build our polynomial regression model, we are going, let's look at the correlation plot. Okay, so let's create the correlation plot. So I'm going to create this variable called CORR. So df.CORR. And here, because this is a heat map, let's say I'm just going to call it HM. So go dot heat map. And inside this, we have, let's say the z-axis will be nothing but correlation, whatever values we get, so call dot values is what will be present in the z-axis. On the x-axis, we have call dot index dot values, and we are going to convert this thing to a list. Lists. All dot index dot values. Okay. You will see why I've written these values of x and y in the same order once we see the graph. Okay, here now we have data is nothing but list of HM. So instead of writing trace, I've written the name HM. Okay, so it's the same thing. Instead of writing trace, I've used this alphabets HM for heat map. Okay, layout is go dot layout. And inside this, let's give a title of, since it's a correlation heat map, so I'm simply calling it core heat map. Next thing is we have to create the figure. So fig is equal to, let's give it a dictionary, and inside dictionary I have data is equal to data, comma, layout is equal to layout. Okay. Once this figure is done, as usual, we have to end it using iplot. So iplot of fig, comma, file name is something like, we'll simply call it heat map. Now let's run this. So here, when you look at this heat map, this is the legend that we have. Okay, so if it is very close to bright yellow, that means it has strong correlation. Otherwise, depending on the color, it has weak correlation. But if I want to know the exact value of how much is the correlation, so I know charges is my target variable. So let's say I want to know the correlation between age and the charges. So here what I will simply do is I'll hover the mouse on that particular cell. Okay, so wherever it intersects, I'm going to hover the charges, hover the mouse over there. So here you can see X and Y. There's a reason we had mentioned the in the code. If you see, we are you might say that we are writing X and Y the same thing, correlation dot index dot values. This is because we were looking at this particular intersection. Both X and Y have the same columns, okay? Age, BMI, children, and charges. But whenever we are going to put a hover and intersection is there, so when we hover on this mouse, it will tell us it is the intersection between what? So between age and charges, there is a 29.90% correlation, okay? Similarly, if we are actually looking at what could be the highest possible value, this is 29, 19, and this is not even 10%. Okay, so 6.79%. So out of these three particular columns, we have age, which has the maximum correlation between the charges. So higher the age, more is the kind of charge that the person is going to incur as insurance. Okay. So insurance premium will be higher for higher age. Okay. The next thing is, let's create a box plot. Okay. So here what I'll do is, for box plot also, we can create the traces and we can look at the plot. Okay. Nancy, exactly how much time I can take further?
Yeah, Partha, now it's 5:40. You can, if you would like to proceed with another 10 to 15 minutes, go ahead.
Okay, 10 to 15 minutes, then what I'll do is, I'm going to skip a few graphs now, and I'm going to take you directly to our building of the model itself. Okay, so here I had actually plotted two more graphs because lot of code was there. I'd already written it out. So this plot is between body mass index and the age category. So here we can see for different combinations. So the person is a smoker and what kind of age bracket the person was in, compared that with the body mass index. So this plot is telling us that kind of information. Okay, so in the box plot, as we know, we have four pieces. That is, apart from the maximum and the minimum value, we have the quartiles. So quartile 3, 2, and 1. So here you can see that maximum value for this particular group, that is young smoker, the maximum value we have for body mass index is around 52, whereas the median value is around 30. Okay, similarly, you can actually compare different age groups and see where exactly is body mass index affecting on the person if the person is a smoker. Okay, now the next plot, which is the most important one, is now that we know the distribution of the charges, we have to figure out what happens if on the basis of the probability, the best kind of model comes in only if the data is normally distributed. Okay, so if we actually take into consideration, if we take the quantiles, okay, so in the quantiles we can actually plot the probability plot. So what the probability plot tells us is, if we have to understand what exactly are we looking for in this plot, is this particular red line that you see. Okay, if the data is actually is following this particular straight line, that means our plot is normally distributed. Okay, so this is the thing what we actually are looking for. So any data which follows this kind of plot is the one we want. So out of these two plots, one is the raw data and one was the scaled logarithmic data. So the scaled logarithmic data, even in the beginning, we saw this in the distribution plot itself, the logarithmic data was following a normal distribution, whereas the actual data or the raw charges data was having this, not a normal distribution, but it was having a positive skewness. Okay. So out of this, looking at the plot itself, we can see for ourselves that we would be more interested to make this kind of or take this kind of data for building our model. Okay, so let's start building the model. So the first thing that we have to do is we have to take the help of label encoding, and we have to make sure those particular columns where we had those categories, those have to be converted back into numbers. Okay, so I'm going to create this object of label encoder, and I'm going to use that. So let's do that. So LE is equal to, so LE is the object that I'm creating. Okay, so here we have LE is nothing but object of label encoder, and I'm going to take this object, fit it to our, let's say first, let's start off with the gender. Okay. And here I'm going to first drop the duplicates, because we know we have only two genders. We don't need extra values over there. This will make sure that we have only the exact values. Okay. And using this, let's transform our raw data. So here we have le.transform, and we're going to transform this entire data using this label encoder that we just built. Okay, so these three lines is going to convert that particular column into numbers. Okay, so let's run this. Once this is run, now let's take a look at the head and see for ourselves that whether or not this particular column has changed. Okay, so now we know this particular column has changed. So now we are not seeing any words like male, female. We are looking at numbers of 0 and 1. Okay, so it has performed. The unique values have been converted. Now the only thing that's left is smoker and the region. And also we have to make sure that we have to do something about this age category. Okay. Now, similarly, even for the, let's target our focus on the region column. Okay. So region column, if I have to find out what are the exact unique values that we have, I'll say dot unique. So these are the unique values that we have. So four categories: Southwest, Southeast, Northwest, Northeast. Okay. Now, as like before, we can do this. Okay, so I'm copying this. So instead of the gender, I'm going to mention this as region. Okay. And in fact, I could have actually copied both. So we can actually save on some more time. Okay, so here we can also say region. It's going to transform into, so using this, we can transform this entire thing. So let's run this. Okay, now we have actually seen this, right? That dot head, now it would be converting into numbers. Now, since we have here four values, there could be a question that I want to know what value was given what number. So if Southwest or Southeast has been given what kind of number, if I want that. Okay, so simply what you can do is, first you can actually type out, we can list out this particular categories that we have. So inside the label encoder, I can simply say le.classes, okay, underscore. So when we type this, okay, here it has become, and so these are the four classes I have: Northeast, Northwest, Southeast, Southwest. Now for the numbers. So for the numbers, what I can do is, let's go for the inverse transformation. So le dot inverse transform, and inside the inverse transform, if I want those values, so I have 0, 1, 2, 3. So corresponding numbers, I will be getting the names now. If I run this, we will see 0 is corresponding to Northeast, 1 to Northwest, 2 to Southeast, and 3 to Southwest. Okay, so this is how you can actually figure out what value is assigned what kind of number. Okay, now all of this is done. So let's see the final data in the head. Okay, so here we have the entire data has been converted to both the gender and the region has been converted to numbers. All that is left to do is we have to do something about the smoker and the age category column. Okay, now before that, let's do one thing. Let's check the correlation between these values. Okay, so correlation, I know we have already done a heat map and we have actually seen the correlations, but if I have to see the entire correlation with respect to charges in one go, okay, instead of hovering around and writing it out, I can actually let Python do all the heavy lifting. So here df.core will give me the correlation values, but this time I'm going to focus only on the charges column because that is my target variable. Okay, and to make my life easier, what I'll do is I'm also going to go for sort values. So it's going to sort out the values so that we'll know exactly which column to focus on. Okay, and since correlation is about a percentage number, so I'm going to multiply it with 100 so that we get the numbers in percentages rather than decimals. So charges with respect to charges is anyway 100, so we can ignore this last piece. Okay, but looking at this entire data, we know we can actually focus on BMI and age. Okay, since age is having the highest value, we are going to, let's build a model based on this. Okay, so the first thing that we can do here right now is we will define the attributes and the target variable. Okay, so if we define the attributes and target variable, building the model, let's say I'm going to drop out the charges. So df.drop. Inside this, I will simply say, this is my target variable, so I don't want this in the attributes. The other thing that I'll drop out is the age category. It is the only column which is not converted yet. So let's drop that out. And you have to clearly mention axis is equal to 1. Okay. Secondly, the y variable is nothing but the target variable, so df charges. This will be very simple. Now, after x and y is declared, we have to actually create our quadratic equation. So polynomial features with 2 degrees I'm taking. So I'm going for a simple quadratic equation. So this equation will be of the form ax squared plus bx plus c is equal to 0. Okay, so that we can do using the following method. So quad is equal to polynomial features. Inside the polynomial features, we will clearly mention we need a degree of 2. So with the quadratic equation, we need a second degree. Okay, now this particular x that we created. Okay, now since we are creating a polynomial regression model, this x, this particular variable x and y we have, we are going to convert this into this particular format so that we get our polynomial regression model. So I'm going to convert the x into this polynomial format. So I'm going to say quad, that is a object that we created for polynomial features. And I'm going to say fit transform. Okay, so fit transform of x. Once we do this, we can actually, okay, here we have an error. Okay, this particular column smoker, we did not convert yet. So let's do that. So I'm going to just copy this. So instead of region, I'm going to convert into smoker. Okay. Once this is converted, let's run this again. Let's run this once again. Now we shouldn't be getting any kind of error. Okay. All right. Now the next thing that we have to do is we have to split the data into training and testing data. Okay. So for training and testing data, the easiest and most simplest method that we can do is take the train test split. Okay, hit shift tab, go to the documentation. Inside the documentation, they're actually giving us a example. Okay, so I'm going to copy this example. All right. So I'm going to leave this in the default values, that is test size of 33% and random state of 42. Okay, the only change I'm going to make here is instead of x, we are going to consider the x quad, the new variable that we created using the fitting of the polynomial features. Okay, and let's run this. So our test and split is complete. Now all that is left to do is you have to create the model. So if we want to create the model, we can simply take, so I'm creating this object called PLR. I'm going to consider linear regression model. But inside this linear regression, I'm going to use this polynomial features thing. So we're actually creating a polynomial regression model. Okay. So let's run this particular piece. Once this is done, let's fit the data into this particular object that we created. So PLR, so I'm simply going to say PLR is equal to PLR.fit. And inside this, I'm going to pass in our training data. Always remember, for this model building, we always use the training data. Testing data cannot be used for the training purposes. Okay. Because using the training data, the model is going to come up with the equation. So always we need to use the training data only. Now, the next thing is, now the model is built, we have to do some kind of predictions and see for ourselves is the model good or not. So I'm going to create this object called ypred. And now that the fitting is complete, we can simply say PLR.predict, and I can pass in the test data over here to make the predictions. Okay. Now ypred is having the predictions. Now, to check how well our model has performed, we can take the help of matrices and see for ourselves as to how well, like what kind of accuracies or results we are getting. So I'm going to take the help of sklearn.matrix. And from there, I'm going to import invariance. Explain variance score and the, let's say, R2 score. Okay. And let's say when the, if we consider mean absolute error, let's say, let's take these three things. So explain variance score, R2 score, and the mean absolute error. Now, if I want to figure out how well the model has performed, I can look at the explained variance score and make a judgment. Okay, so here if I say explained variance score, and inside the explained variance score, I pass in the y test and the y pred that we just made the predictions on. Okay, so to pass this, we get a score of 85.50. That means this particular model that we built, this model is able to predict 85.5% of the charges. Okay, so if we see, we have only dropped the charges and the age category, right? That means age, gender, BMI, number of children, smoker, region, all these variables put together can actually predict 85.5% of the charges correctly. So whenever using this model, we can say we are almost, we are always 85.5% times right. Okay. Now, if we really have to look at the residuals, that is what kind of errors is the model making. Okay, so for this I'm going to take the help of Seaborn. In Seaborn, let's do a simple distribution plot, and distribution plot is between our y test, the actual values of the model, and I'm going to compile the y test with the predictions. Okay, so when we run this, there's some error. Yeah, this should have been double bracket. So because we only want one number, and we're going to take the error. Okay, so instead of comma, it should have been minus. So y test minus y pred. If we do this, we can see that most of our values are hovering around zero. Okay. It's not exactly zero. If it were exactly zero, that would mean our predictions and the actual values were the same, which no model can actually achieve. Okay, it is a utopian concept that our predictions would be exactly equal to the actual values. But we should be happy that most of our data points are hovering around zero. That means this if we use this model, we can actually make decent predictions. Okay. So this, by looking at the residuals itself, we can make this judgment call whether or not this model is performing really well. The other way you can check this model's accuracy is by looking at the R2 score. If the R2 score is close to one, you can say the model is really good. If you print R2 score, and inside the R2 score, you're going to pass in the Y test and the Y pred, we're getting a score of 85.48, which is very, very good. It's closer to one. So we can say that our model is performing really good. Okay. So this is what I had for you guys today. Do we have any questions?
Partha, could you please check the chat box? I think, there were a couple of questions.
Okay. Okay. Polynomial regression, when we actually use polynomial regression is when we see that the data is not following a typical linear pattern. So let's say in linear regression, we have this equation y is called mx plus c. That means whenever x is increasing, y correspondingly increases. But what happens, let's say if my equation is something like y is equal to x square. Let's take the equation of a circle. Okay. Here we cannot simply apply the linear regression because x is not with x, y is not increasing linearly, but there is some power associated with it. Okay. It's not only the square. If it were a cubic equation or the fourth power or fifth power or whatever power, if it is following, that is when we actually apply polynomial regression. Okay. So whenever you actually draw the graph, so when we were plotting the charts, there when you actually figure out using the visualizations that it's not following a linear path, there is some other relation between these two variables, you can actually go for polynomial regression and check it. Okay.